Okay, just a little introduction to what I do and who I am. I'm Neha Modgil. I started my career as an architect, where I used to design buildings and I used to do interior design. When I used to take my consumers out to the store and used to just observe how they shop, it was very interesting how they would choose fabrics, how the fabric that was kept in front suddenly got more attention to the one in the back. I observed all that and I suddenly got interested in the retail theory of how people buy. Which then took me to doing my master's in design, and then I specialized in designing retail stores for the web space. I'm not sure of the profile of the audience here. I had a request to the organizers if you could let me know, what level is the audience at so that I can orient it there. If you find the stuff too basic, please raise your hand. If you find it too advanced, please raise your hand. I haven't even started. I said when I start, so that we can talk in that language. I'll also leave my contact coordinates, so if you want to contact me later. But before we start, if you could just raise hands, who is in the process right now of starting to thinking of designing an internet store or a web store? Okay, great. And who has already got a web store and is wanting to maybe refurbish it? Okay, so we have a mix of basic and intermediate. Cool. What we're going to cover here today is largely how do you think of the web store from a front-end perspective. I'm not going to talk of back-end, no theory on Magento better than OS Cart or PHP better than ASP.NET. It's purely going to be from a user-centered design perspective. When a user comes to your site, whatever you're selling, you could be selling jobs on your site, you could be selling rented homes, you could just be selling wines on your site. How do you go about it is what we're largely going to talk about. A little bit about what we do. TechWith Consulting is the company that I run out of Mumbai. We're into four main areas. We're into business consulting, which is online business consulting. So people come to us and say, my registration dropouts are very high. Can you look into it and tell me how, from the front end standpoint, I can improve it? So that's the kind of business consulting we do. Design, where it's purely user interface design. User research and evaluation, we have our own usability test lab. We've done user research for a lot of clients, from eBay to Quikr to Naukri, Jeevan Sathi, where we do user research and give them a feedback on how you could improve your interface. Technology development is something we started off late when clients would come and say, why don't you also develop the site for us? Okay. We're going to talk about planning and designing web store user interface. I want it to be a lot of interactivity in the session, so please talk, ask questions, don't wait till the end, and let there be a lot of interaction. Okay, even before we begin, I want everyone to be on the same platform. What's a web store? Anyone, just shout out. What's a web store? On the net. Okay. Sorry? Okay, so you can buy products on the website. Is Naukri.com a web store? How many yes, how many no's? Yes. And why do the yes ones say yes? Okay, and why do the no's say a no? I thought there was a majority of no's. Why would, okay, monster.com, is that a web store? No, it's not. Why it's not? I just want to hear the why of knots. Okay. So he's saying that it's a service provider. You buy it once and it's continuous. Okay. Would you look at, the end product of, or the database of candidates on Naukri is called a RESTEX as a product. So would it be a product or a service that they give you? It would still be a product, right? So it would still be a product. So basically, wherever transaction happens online, a Jeevan Sathi, for example, is again a web store. So web store would be any transaction-based platform. transaction of any kind. Now, and the transaction could be a cash on delivery transaction, it could be a one-time payment transaction, but whatever happens online becomes a web store then, because you're basically going on the web to purchase that. So yeah, examples, like anything. You can sell cakes to jobs to ties, anything that you sell is a web store. Okay, another quick question. What's the difference between a brick and mortar retail store and a web store? What? Lower investment in what? No, so in a brick and mortar store or a web store? Okay, lower investment in a web store. Real was. Okay, so one is very real, where you go, touch, feel, tactile, and in the other one you select virtually. Which one is immediate? Okay, sure. Okay. So brick and mortar is local, and that is global. Fair? Okay, so there's a time constraint, and there's no time constraint. You buy any time. Okay? Okay, so you go there and you don't go there. So there's a movement that a person has to do. Okay, so the tactile bit is missing. We discussed that. What about when you go inside the retail store and, you know, when you start looking around, do you think there's a difference between the experience of being in, say, a Pantaloon mall or one of the malls, Shoppers Stop, versus an online Shoppers Stop? How would you compare that difference? Okay. Okay. So there's no personal assistance on a web store. Oh, that's excellent. So in a retail store, there's, you know, you see like a 3D view. You look around, you see a panoramic view versus a web store where you just see one shot perhaps, or a tunnel view. Oh, so you mean all the products? Sure. Sure. So the experience is of variety, and is higher in a physical store? Why is that? Interesting, cross-selling. So, in fact, these are very interesting points which we'll maybe touch base later. Any other distinctions in the experience of buying? So how are the dynamics different? What do you mean by that? Oh, so you mean the interaction itself? Okay.
Dynamics to deal with, yep. Which is human-computer interaction. Right?
Sure.
So these are some very interesting observations. We'll park them here for now, because we've at least been able to reach a consensus that there is a difference between a brick and mortar store, the experience there, versus a web store. The next question I have is, should there be a difference? And this is a classic debate that's all over the globe. Why is there a difference? And should there be a difference? And what have we as user interface practitioners done to bridge that gap? Because what people are looking at, I'll come back to this question after we've gone through this entire presentation, and we'll again answer this, that, you know, how do we bridge that gap? But this presentation will basically talk about bridging that gap. Because when a consumer has gone to a retail store, why is an Indian consumer, you know, the biggest hesitation he has on buying in an online store? So we do a lot of researches, and the biggest hesitation that stops him. Okay, because, you know, Make My Trips and IRCTC, they're perfectly fine paying by credit cards today or debit card today. Touch and feel and quality, perhaps.
I think more of what you are ordering, do you get that or not?
To some extent, but to a large extent, that personal assistance of, you know, what I'm ordering, will I get that? And if it's defected, who do I get in touch with? So that is the biggest showstopper today. And you, if you're starting a web store, have to ponder on these things, that, you know, how do I help my consumer or give him that, you know, feel-good factor of I'm there even if you get into trouble. So don't worry. And that's the biggest showstopper. If you can address that, I think we've addressed a biggest problem that Indian audience is today facing of who do I get in touch with if something goes wrong with my product. Okay. So this is about bridging the gap between real world and virtual world. Some quick pointers on how we can do it. The first thing that you need to identify is who is buying my product, when are they buying it, and how soon do they need it. These three questions that you need to ask yourselves. Is the product who's buying, the person who's buying my product, is he a child? Is he a pregnant woman? Or is it a male audience who's, you know, office going? Because once you've identified that, you'll start finding solutions to the problem. So first you identify the audience, and then you identify what are the problems probably with this audience when he comes online and buys. Time could be a problem, trust could be a problem, variety could be a problem. So you'd only know it once you've identified who is the guy who's coming online to buy. And why do I say when do they need it? Because, for example, somebody is buying a birthday cake to gift to a girlfriend. They need it at 12 o'clock. Once you've identified that, you can give him a solution of express delivery and maybe charge him higher. But if you haven't identified the use case of who's the user, when does he want it, how soon does he want it, you'll never be able to give those solutions online, right? Or it could be somebody, so we were doing this site called India Cake for a client of ours. They deliver cakes all over the country. So we were doing this user research and we found that it's not just cakes that people want to send. Their USP was that we sell cakes online. If you've got somebody's birthday, you can just order from us. And when we did this research, we realized that it's not just cakes. They also want to send flowers with it. So, you know, because they're mostly sending it to friends or parents. They're NRIs. They're sending it to siblings here in India. So they also want to send flowers. Sometimes they also want to send chocolates or teddy bears. So we then started packaging these products together. That, you know, with the cake, you can also buy flowers. With the cake, you can also buy teddy bears. So you've got to have an understanding of who's buying, what they're buying it for, when do they need it, at what time of the day perhaps they need it. So they didn't have, for example, earlier on their site that a question that they just asked the date. They never asked what time of the day do you want it. And that itself was a jump in user experience once they just put that question in, what time of the day do you want it? And they ensured that the delivery happens half an hour, 30 minutes, plus minus that time. So that itself got some trust on the site. And people thought that, you know, this guy understands my need. He knows what I want. Another very important criteria, decisions taken when buying an item. So to give you an example, when I'm buying an apparel, when I'm buying, when my husband's buying a shirt, for example, he wears it, and in fact, we all do that. We go to the trial room, we look at ourselves from the front, and then we turn around and we look at ourselves from the back, and then the sides. So I had always questioned why on e-commerce sites they only show me one, you know, standard pose of a front shot. Why don't they show me this is how you look in the front, this is how you look in the back? And we tried this with one of the user interface that we created for Madura Garments. Madura Garments is the manufacturer of Allen Solly and Pantaloon. Sorry, I'm just gasping for breath. Coming from Bombay, Delhi is like really chilly for me. So I did a lot of exercise in the morning to keep myself warm during the day. So I'm just tired. Okay. So Madura Garments is the manufacturer of Pantaloon and Allen Solly and Pantaloon they've recently bought, but Peter England, all these brands. They just recently launched a site called trendin.com. We were doing the user interface of that, and that's when we suggested that, you know, on the product detail page, for example, don't just have the front shot. Have the front shot and the back shot. Let people see two shots at a time, because then they'll be able to take a decision whether they want to buy this or, you know, discard it. We did the design, and we showed it to a couple of people and compared it to some other traditional sites. We just had one shot. And the reaction was very different. People loved it. They just loved the idea that I'm now a very small thing. It's not such a big thing, and it's not even a thing that needs technological advancement to implement. It just needs a thought. It just needs to someone to think that what is the decision that the person needs to take when he's buying this item. So for example, if you look at Naukri.com, when you search taking on your site and what information they need to take those decisions, once you've identified that, you'll be able to provide that information. Showcase product variety. Somebody mentioned that, you know, when you walk into a store, you see a panoramic view of all the products. I'm yet to see an e-commerce site which shows you all the products which have a delight. I mean, I would love to see products just displayed and I just scroll and I see more and more products. Why can't we design like that? Where I just see categories. Even you look at any e-commerce site, they're all built just the same way. They all have categories in a drop-down or in the top navigation. Nobody's really experimented with having a visual display of categories, just the way you enter a store. When you enter a store, you just look around. You're not given a pamphlet or a brochure saying, you know, this is the categories, walk left for shirts, walk right for trousers. You don't do that. You have a visual view of all your categories. And that's what we need to do. So whatever you're showcasing, have a visual view of that. Display your variety. Display total pricing upfront. I can't tell you how much people hate it when we do researches when taxes are hidden, when only base prices are shown when they have to travel, only the base price and, you know, all the airport taxes, etc., are only told to them when they reach the shopping cart. It's an awful experience. And they may buy it because they need it, but if they had a choice, they would not come back to that site. So be transparent. Show your pricing upfront. If they have to buy it, they'll buy it. If they don't have to buy it, they'll not buy it. But at least be truthful and honest when you're showing your pricing on your site. Customer service, very important actually, should have been right in the beginning. Customer service is what we were talking about a while ago. Why people drop out? Because there's no one to tell them, you know, we are there to help you. Interestingly, we were just doing a competitive research for a client of ours, where we also picked up Flipkart as one of their competitors. We were doing it for a competitor of Flipkart. And 30 people we must have spoken to, all 30 people, all of them, when asked in the end, they used 3-4 sites, and they were asked in the end, you know, which experience do you think is better? The task flows were exactly the same, the pages looked exactly the same, but when asked, do you want to take a guess which one they thought was the better experience? So we were looking at a couple of e-commerce sites, Flipkart was one of them. All 30 of them said Flipkart is a better experience. I said, you know, it's just the same. Why do you say that? And they were all e-commerce buyers. They were advanced users of e-commerce. So they all said, because, you know, whenever we've had a problem, they've replaced our product. So that brand recall and the customer relation that they've built is so strong that people just love the brand, even if they're shown another brand which has exactly the same looking screens. So customer service is something you've got to be very, very thoughtful about. Okay, that's the website conversion funnel. How many people are aware of this? You know, the conversion funnel on any website? Okay, we've got a couple of people. Good. So for people who are not aware, this is how you basically measure the conversion on your website. Number of people coming to your landing page. Now, the landing page could either be your home page or it could be your search results page. Home page, when people have typed in the URL and they've landed. Search results page, when they've usually come through Google and they come on a search results page. So either of these could be treated as your landing page. After that, they go to the product information page, which is the product detail page. Then they go to the shopping cart page, and then the checkout. And that's a typical funnel. People start dropping out as they proceed further. And any e-commerce product person's job is to improve the funnel, to improve the base of the funnel. That's the KPI of that person in the organization, that funnel kitna hai, kitne log aaye, how many people landed, and how many people actually checked out. And if you're planning to run an e-commerce business, or if you're running an e-commerce business, and if you're not already doing it, this is something that you need to, on maybe a weekly basis, look at these numbers. Because these are the numbers that you need to improve. These are the only numbers that can help you know what's happening on your site, how many people are coming in, and how many people are actually buying. And where are the bounces higher? Which page? Typically, bounces are higher in the checkout and the shopping cart page. There could be many reasons, but we're only going to talk about the user interface reasons, or you know, how you can improve your user interface to improve the bounce rates on these pages. Okay, landing page. Any questions so far? Good. Yeah. I didn't get the question.
Why would they choose a different brand name when they have so many to run with?
And you mean why did they choose to call themselves trendin.com?
Yeah, and also they have brick and mortar, so many stores, also multi-brand outlets, I think Planet Retail or something. They could have used any of them.
So one of the reasons was they want to be known, they want to create an online platform where all the brands are housed together. So they've got about five or six brands selling on Esprit and Pantaloon and Allen Solly, Peter England, all of them selling under the same brand. So it was important for them to give it one umbrella brand name. They couldn't have called it Peter England or Allen Solly. They had to call it one consolidated name. So they chose to call it whatever. Sorry? No, not all of them. Planet Fashion is another entity. Planet Fashion, if I'm not wrong, is the export entity of theirs. Any other questions? Okay, we're good to go. Let's talk about the landing page or the home page. The one most important thing you can do to your landing page or home page is give a clear and defined logo. So one is, you know, give your, we're not going to get into details of how do you choose the name of the website and, you know, the science behind that. Maybe we can discuss that offline. But once you've discussed and decided what is the name that you want to give to your web store and you've got the logo designed, it's imperative that you place it in a position where it's seen clearly. What do you think is the correct position of the logo? Top left, right, top right, top left, top right, top left. How many for top right? Top right. Okay, and how many for top left? Okay, why top right and why top left? There has to be a reason on whatever you do. You can't just do it. Okay. So you just place the logo here. But you can place the logins here, right? Okay. Yeah, but we've got the answer there. Because we are left to right readers, if you look at all the Urdu and the Arabic sites, they have their logos on the right. But if you look at all the English sites, they've got their logos on the left, because the first thing you want the user to know when he's landed on your site is, you know, what's the logo or what's the company or what's the website, because it doesn't take him long. it is said that if the guy is on your website for 4 seconds, it's a good thing, because it doesn't take him long to close the browser and go to another competitive site. Yep. Right, right. So there's a difference there. When you're on the TV channel, you choose to see a Star News or a India TV or, you know, a Star channel. Here you're landed through Google. You don't even know sometimes what is the website you've landed on. Right? On TV, it's not like that. Maybe when you're surfing also, you're kind of aware what you're doing. But here, and you've got 40, 50, 70 channels. Here you've got crores of sites. And you sometimes don't know where you've landed. So it's important to have it on the left. Also, the other reason is because you're not reading on the TV. You're reading on the website, right? So you're reading, and your reading pattern is also very scannable. I mean, you don't read every line. If you think on your website people are going to read every line, you're wrong. They're only going to read, there's another pattern to how they read on the screen. But on the TVs, you don't read, you just watch. It's very visual. It's not supposed to be read. Okay, so some examples of well-defined clear logos. You'll have to tell me, is this a good or a bad one? Is this a good or a bad logo placement? And, you know, clarity, etc. I don't know how to clear it. Very good. This one? How many for goods and how many for bads? Bad? Anyone for good? Why good and why bad? Okay. Can't see the logo, very small. Somebody said it's good also. Why is it good? They're the Adidas loyalists. Okay. But tell me one thing, when you go to an Adidas store, have you seen the hoardings or the, you know, outside the poster or the signage outside? Is it small or big? It's pretty big, right? It attracts your attention. They don't have to. By that logic. The entire store is black for a different reason. That's to highlight the products, right? So, but the point here is when you land on the website, and this is debatable, there's no answer correct or wrong to it. Maybe you'll have to go to their brand people and ask them what they've done. And it's personal opinions. But if you ask me, they could have highlighted the logo and maybe made it a little clutter-free. There are too many elements around the logo. So even if they had to highlight the products, which I agree with, it didn't have to have so many elements around it. It could have probably had a more clutter-free look to it. And, okay, is the product not highlighted here?
As a visual designer, you can clearly see that the logo is not in proportion with the rest of the page.
Right.
It's very...
So is the logo, is the product not visible here? I'm saying minimizing the logo is not the only way to highlight your product. Your product can be highlighted by highlighting the logo also. Right, so the defense that because they wanted to highlight the product and hence they did injustice to the logo may not be the right defense.
Slightly different. If you look at this, there are also various proportions to how exactly you fit in the logo. And these are actually international communications. Incidentally, I work for the brand, so I can talk.
You work
about
with Adidas?
Okay. So, purpose here very clearly is that we are talking about a particular product here. Even if you go to a store, it is all black. Even if you see outside, the logo is of a particular size. It cannot exceed the entire hoarding, maybe of a huge size. But still, the logo will be only of a particular size, because that is how the entire brand is justified. You do not increase the size of the brand inordinately just to show it, because finally there is a brand depiction and there are size measurements that you put
through. Sure, I understand. So I'm not going to argue with the brand guy. It's worth doing the research and calling you in for the research and actually seeing the feedback. Okay. What about this? Good or bad? Good? The only thing you can read. Right. So this was just an example to show that it doesn't have to be always on the top right. It just has to be clearly placed. People have put it on the top right because it gets otherwise lost in a lot of other things. But you can perhaps treat it in a different way if you can, and still highlight it. Bad SEO. You can't make everyone happy, right? Okay, what about this? Good or bad?
Good.
Okay, how many goods, how many bads? I know the session is after lunch, but it's okay.
Good.
And how many bads? And some people are not even raising their hands, they don't care. Okay, why good and why bad? Okay, and why good?
I get
it. The idea is to get attention.
If we were not doing this logo exercise, would you have known this is the logo?
On second thought, yes. Because you can see axis in other angle also.
See, it's disruptive. If it's disruptive, it is an open door interpretation. So it can be good or it can be bad. But obviously, it is not something which is a normal practice.
Hmm.
If the idea is to catch attention, it does.
Hmm. Okay. I like that word disruptive. Are you from a design background?
No. Sales.
Okay. A lot of sales. Okay. A lot of design people, especially the ones who work in the ad agency, use this word very often. And everything comes under the garb of being disruptive or being different. But you have to remember, in an e-commerce store, you're talking of business, you're talking of transactions. You're not just talking of being different. If you can be different and still adhere to the psychology of how people shop online, it's great. But if you can't, then you're not even fulfilling the purpose of doing an online business. So do it the traditional way, if you can. It doesn't matter. It doesn't hurt anyone, as long as you're making money, if the aim is to make money. But if you're only making a site which looks very different, then forget about business. Then you can't do an online store. Right, so you have to get your goal very right. I haven't seen an online store which does excellent, which has a very non-traditional look to it. When we did the research with this one, and we showed it to people, 90% people could not figure out what the company was about unless they saw the brand, the URL, and then they figured out, oh, this is Mex, and then they saw also MEXS written there. That when we did the research, the banner was different. It didn't have MEXS. Okay, another very common one, maybe we all know about it, but we're just going to talk about it a little more. People think it's an Indian phenomenon, but let me tell you, it's a global phenomenon. If you have discounts and deals, put them up front. If you don't put them up front, people will not know. If you put them a click behind, people will not know. If you put it up front, you will see your sales go up at least by 30% easily. If you have a good product on discount or deal. So if you have a discount or a deal, please flaunt it on the home page. It's important. Also on the search results page, considering a lot of people are landing on the search results page. The search results page trend of showing discounts is very recent. Only recently people have realized that, if people have searched, for example, diapers on Google, landed on a search results page of a baby store which has diapers, it's good to show the discounts on the top so that it helps them take a purchase decision. So, this is a site called Bigadda.com. They also sell electronic products, gadgets, mobile phones. Why I'm showing you this is, if you look at this one, it clearly tells you jackets at 50% off. Very alluring, very lucrative. You'll probably click on it to look at the jackets. Here it doesn't tell you. What it expects the user to do is click on deals or on offers, go to that page, and then see what the deals or offers there are. Which, in my opinion, could have been done in a better way. You could have got the deals and offers out on the home page, And that could have been an entry point for a consumer to go to that section. Right? So deals, offers, discounts is something that you've got to capitalize upon if you've got them running on your side. In fact, I remember one of our clients, I won't name who they were, they said, you know, we are a high-end brand. If you're making our store, we don't want to be perceived as a sale and a discount place. It's okay, just put everything behind a tag called sale, and we'll only showcase our products on the homepage. 6 months down the line, they were forced to get the sales item again on the homepage because that's what drives traffic. That's what lets people go into your site. That is a user psyche all over the world. Display of popular and new products. Again, we've got the same example. If you've got anything popular, if you've got anything new, this is again talking of bridging the gap between an offline store and an online store. When I'm walking into a mall, have you ever thought what triggers your decision to enter a shop or not enter a shop? The what? The window display, right? And what is displayed on the windows? What are the mannequins usually wearing?
Fresh arrivals.
Fresh arrivals, right? So it's fresh winter wear or fresh sports wear or whatever it is fresh is usually displayed right in the front, which the retail designer knows will trigger the guy's decision to walk inside the store. And a lot of times, if you just stand inside the store and observe people, you will have a lot of women walk in and say, "Jo usne pehna hai na, wohi mujhe dikhana." Right? So it is also that thing of what this person is wearing and it's looking so nice, I want to wear the same thing. It's an aspirational value that they're building upon. So, and the similar thing with your own websites or your web stores. Build on the aspirational value. Let there be popular products, new products displayed on the landing page, on the home page. Even when your landing page is a search results page, show the new products or fresh arrivals first to the consumer. So this is the trend in, that I was talking about. We've done this, but I'm still going to talk about it. Do you think this is, you know, this is a good example of displaying of new products or popular products? So it's not one of the good examples. Although we've done this, but you know, when you're taking design decisions, there are a lot of other factors that play. But I feel the homepage could have had a lot of more engagement points for the consumer. New products, recently added, discount, people are buying this, etc., etc. The more engagement factors you build on your homepage, the more path you're creating for the consumer to get inside the website, right? And in India, it is said, "Jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai." So whatever you show on the homepage will get a lot of clicks and will finally convert. We were redoing babyoy.com. Babyoy is a baby store where there a lot of baby products are sold online. One of their earlier stores, which was in 2010, was just a homepage with a banner and a couple of categories on display. And all that we did to the homepage was we opened those categories. So if there's a category called toys, we just showed popular toys and we opened it up with 5-6 popular toys with a more there. Similarly, we did with 2-3 more categories, which were their hot selling categories. That's all that we did. It took us 10 days to do it, but it increased their sales by 25%, which is a huge jump. There would be other factors. The technology got a little better, faster, but this also played a very important role in boosting their sales. So always remember, what are the engagement points that you've created for your consumer on the homepage? Social media. How many on Facebook? How many on Facebook? Everyone, right? How many not on Facebook? Oh, there is a person not on Facebook. Two people. Okay. It is said that 20%, this is a international statistics, not Indian statistics, 20% of online purchases are made after browsing through social media sites. I'm not sure what the Indian statistics would be, but if it's not 20%, in a year's time, it will become 20%. So it's important to have social media displayed importantly or upfront on your site, again, landing page again, preferably on the header or the footer. So if you look at Zovi, for example, they've got 129,000 likes, and they're proud of it. They put it right on the top. What it does to you when you come in, it makes you trust the site. You think so many people have liked the site, there has to be something good about it, right? Customer care numbers, very, very critical. Please do not shy away. The first thing you do when you start a web store is get a customer care person there. Or, you know, if you don't have a toll-free number, that's fine. People don't mind spending, 50 paisa or 60 paisa on the call. But have somebody attend those calls and have that number displayed there up front. What it does to the consumer is it gives them the satisfaction that there is somebody there who will answer my call if I have a product that is received which is in a damaged condition. We were doing a research for eBay, and eBay has a product called eBay Guarantee. Now, I don't know why they have a product called eBay Guarantee. What eBay Guarantee basically does is, it's a guarantee that if you get the product which is damaged, eBay will help you return it to the supplier, because eBay is a platform, it's a marketplace model. So it will help you return it to the supplier. And they've got eBay Guarantee very nicely on the homepage and on all the other pages. And what do you think was consumers' reaction to it when they, you know, when we did the research and they saw eBay Guarantee?
Reliable?
Okay.
Confidence?
Okay. What else? So the problem was that nobody understood what eBay Guarantee was. So if you got something like an eBay Guarantee, just call it, you know, a better name. When they saw eBay Guarantee, they thought kuch guarantee warranty hoga products ke upar. But nobody really cared to click and read more on what is eBay Guarantee, right? So if you've got customer care, please uncomplicate and say this is customer care. Instead of giving it a fancy product's name called eBay Guarantee or, you know, whatever. So I'm not against that. I mean, they must have given their own thought to it. But the way of implementing it perhaps was incorrect. Okay. Now, one quick exercise, because you know people on the back are not even raising their hands, they just look so tired. I want you guys, you have notepads and pens, all of you?
Yep.
Have the sponsors given you notepads and pens?
No.
Yes, yes.
No? Okay, so if you have notepads and pens, now that we've learned so much about the landing page and the home page, we'll do this in groups, everybody's sitting together, can be one group, and on the back side you could make a group of three people perhaps. Yeah? You'll group up in teams of three? Okay. The back side is so quiet.
Back benches.
And what you need to do is, in the next 10 minutes, come up with a home page for a website that sells wines online. Very quick doodle can be okay, but what is important is not what you create. What is important is the thought behind what you create. So you've got to discuss amongst yourselves who's going to buy my wine. This is high-end wine, very expensive. So who's going to buy my wine? Why will they buy it online? What can I do to cater to that guy? And is there anything special you need to do because you're selling wine, et cetera, et cetera. 10 minutes flat. And not to forget, the best presenter gets free consultation on their web store. Thank you. done first, please raise your hands.
Hello.
I thought they were presenting. You can be the second one.
One, sorry.
You can be the third one, if time permits. No, no, come, you'll explain it to the audience. Do we have split sessions or is Pradeep taking a session after this? Do you know?
Yeah, he's taking a session.
He's taking it in parallel. So if I run a little late, it's okay with me. So they're going to present their concept. They're going to talk about what they've called their site to how they went about designing it and what's their design.
Hello everyone. What's your name?
Vishal.
Vishal. So we randomly four people from four organizations. What do you thought of? We try to interview each other. How do you buy wine and why do you buy wine? So Rajiv, he's a
connoisseur.
Yeah.
Wine connoisseur.
And Sunil, he says, I want to buy based on is it a red wine, white wine, or sparkling wine. I was the one who did not even know there's something called sparkling wine. Okay. So, and then he said, I will go by price range. So we understood that target segment could be anyone between 25 to 60 years old, men, female. So no bifurcation. Anyone could be a visitor to our site. But there were two strikingly different types of user. One who is very knowledgeable would like to buy a wine based on certain criterias, like which region it is from, or is it a red wine or white wine, or
if it's a vintage or not, and what grape.
Yeah, region, grape, or age. Yeah. And second type of user would be one who would just say red wine, white wine, or price range. So what we thought, that homepage should have a split screen. Something like on the top, we have a user interface that gives the choice of selecting a wine based on all these two, three parameters like region, grape, and age. The second just below that would be something which will just allow users to select red, white, sparkling, and then based on a price slider, he can arrange. So
the homepage will be a mix of, you know, Ajax kind of a workout, wherein you know, you slide out the price, the region in terms of the countries where you are looking at, and the, on the right hand side of the split homepage, the kind of search results keep, you know, dynamically changing. That sort of a design for the advanced kind of search user, and for the normal kind of users, a big icon split of red wine, white wine,
red wine,
and sparkling
and
wine.
White,
that
sparkling
sort of design we have actually.
I cannot
prepared.
Show you the layout. I will try to explain it again. For advanced user, you have on the left hand side, you have a price slider, and below that you have a
country slider.
You can
the horizontal axis.
Grapes.
Increase the range of countries you want to select and just decrease it. And on the right hand pane, you will have all the products coming in. There you can select white, red, or multi-select. And the product labels that will have image of wines will come over. If you hover a particular tile of wine image, it will flip and will show you the exact label so that you know, okay, this is the bottle shape, this
the
bottle
product
color.
Info and
product info it will give you in on the splits flip. Something like that.
Thank you.
But one thing guys, itna bolne ke baad bhi you didn't give a customer care numbers anywhere. Will he spend more than 4 seconds in trying out?
Yeah, this, yeah, very intuitive price slider and products are changing and then you are changing your region. So, you know, something interesting.
Okay. All by the way? What did you call it? Vino.
Okay. We can also click the picture. We can send it by Bluetooth if you want to show it to everybody.
Yeah, sure.
Should we do that?
Yeah. I have to get my Bluetooth on. I'm not a tech person. Can you help me?
Yeah, sure. Let me...
This one.
this one works. Hey, this has gone to slideshow.
Sorry. Absolutely sorry. Not personal, everything is public in this world. Now stop. Tell it to stop. Ruk ja. Ye nahi, ye kiske piche hai. Ruk ja.
Okay. So, name of our companies is Neha Wine Cellar. Okay. We thought we'll get some extra marks due to that. Okay. And the basic page design is, I'll just explain you here. So this is our logo, which is basically a wine bottle, wine pouring out of it. Okay, and the sparkle you can see in the wine. That's basically our logo. This is designed as a door. Okay, this is like a cellar door. And inside the cellar, we basically have a world map. Okay, so one insight which we got from him is, that most of the people try to decide based on locality, country which the wine comes from, and French are supposed to be most exotic. So we'll have a world map which you see through a cellar door. And in every country, what we'll show is, we'll show a woman in traditional dress holding a wine of that country. And if you click on that, you get more details of that.
If you point on that, it gives you a list of all the wines which are... If you point on that, you get list of all the wines which are manufactured in that area. So that would be our homepage, selling wines of the world to the world.
And the most important point, the name is Neha Wine Cellar.
Neha's Wine Cellar.
Not required, but okay. What are the, what's the feedback on the homepage? Any feedback? No customer care number. Sorry? Any other feedback? Yeah, feedback? Show the design. I don't know if we have time. They're going to soon ask me to stop. Feedback?
While loading.
That's what I told you. Just copy and paste. No, khuli hui hai.
Okay.
Yeah, right. Okay. So, I'll tell you my opinion on the homepage. One of the things was that I noticed there was no picture of the product at all. Right? So, if I'm on a product, if I rolled over, right? What we do as a very common mistake, we expect people to roll over. So they land on the site, they see a map. They may or may not roll over. Considering 50% rolled over, 50% did not, the 50% who did not roll over, you've lost them. Right? And the 50% who did roll over perhaps found interest, and another 25% went in, and another 10% actually bought. So you've already got your channel funnel down by 50% by keeping a product on a rollover. Right? Remember I said that jo dikhta hai wahi bikega, jo nahi dikhega wo nahi bikega web par. That's the common fundamental of website in India. Yeah. Right. So now you're expecting a person to see an abstract logo and understand that it's a wine bottle, and it perhaps means that they sell wines. The other very common mistake we make when we are designing, we think that, you know, this is sparkling wine, very clear. Please take it out to your users and ask your users, do you understand this is sparkling wine? And look at the answers that come back to you, right? The answers may not really match what you thought. When you're designing a site, I've seen a lot of designers, I myself do that, a lot of designers say, but this is written here, you know, like they'll have for example, write phone number, and there'll be a big text field where person can type in the phone number. Below that, it'll say that you can write up to 10 digits or something, or maybe STD code, after STD code, put a hyphen and then write the number. And I was arguing, I said, why don't you write, give two boxes, which make it explicit that first is for STD code, the other one is for the number. And he said, niche likha to hai, can't they read it? But I'm sorry, people don't read. That's the problem. people do not read on the web, they do not have time to read on the web. So can you give them a design solution which doesn't make them read, or it becomes intuitive even without reading? So having a map may be a good idea, but if you're wanting to sell, perhaps having a map may not be a good idea.
The other thing was, I think what we gathered from what you had told us on the landing page, it has to be as clear as possible, so, with offers and engagement ideas running there. So probably with a world map and I think signage of a bottle there, I might miss that out completely on the offer side, and on somebody who is high, you said high-end wines, right? So then what's the other engagement points beside that map?
Hi everyone, this is Prabhjot here. That's the image we doodled. Okay, so I'll start from the top. This here is our logo. The name is wineworld.com. Our logo is a W and another W under it. Here is the URL. Right on the top we have Facebook. That is, we have around more than a lakh likes. Then there's Twitter, etc. Right next to is our free customer care phone number, 1-800, etc. There's a clear search tab right over here. Then we have a scroll going on with our popular wines that you can click and see. Right below is you buy three wines, you get one free. There's names mentioned like Jacob's Creek, Kamala, Hardy Sector, and there's a link for it to click for more. And right up next to it are three different wines shown, red wine, white wine, rose wine. Again, there's a click for more wines. Below we are mentioning free delivery, 100% returns, cash on delivery. On the right side, we have a few combos going on for wine coolers, wine glasses, bottle openers, vintage wines, etc. And of course, a more link with it. Below, we have a link for the banks connected with us, ICICI, HDFC, SBI, and 100% trusted, etc. logos. And right at the bottom, we have TechWed, the company that made it for us. Thank you.
Okay, any comments there? Cool. Any comments on this one? It's not high end? And what makes you think it's not high end? You want to present? Will we have time for another one? Yeah? Okay, before that. So what if you got a bottle that was cracked?
I think it'd be the inside.
What if you got a damaged bottle? Is it because you're buying wine? Or do you think you don't generally need information on the homepage? Okay, okay. And I think that's a good comment. That's an interesting comment that luxury is perhaps, or the high-endness is perhaps missing, where it's probably a street place where, you know, maybe you've gone to a pub, you haven't gone to a high-end five-star hotel where you're sitting in a bar. So I think that's the difference. But I think it's a good attempt, nevertheless.
Okay, my team actually went off, so I'm there. Okay, our site name is spiritual.com, which is again on the left-hand side top. And then on the center top, again, we have the toll-free number. That's 1-800-121-1800. Then we have search on right top, which says Be Spiritual With. You type in there whatever you want to type in for searching your wines. Then we have FB, Twitter, and then wine meetups, wherein you just click and you can search for all the wine meetups in your locations. Then there's a big banner which says Oldest Monk Now For You, 1860 wine at $35,000. And there's a monk who's sitting, who's elated, who's spiritual, who's meditating because of the wine. Then we have three categories, which says Oldest Sold Wines as one category, and about three bottles which are shown. Underneath we have written the rates, the country, and the labels. Then we have red wine, then we have white wine as the category, and then the bottom is normal footer. That's our site. I don't know if you can see, I'm not good in drawing, but I can just forward it. All right. Thanks, guys.
We can talk later. I'm here till late. Okay, we've got a design which has Katrina Kaif also. Okay, back from wines. Did that wake up everybody? The idea was to wake up everyone. Okay. Like I said, there are two kinds of landing pages. You can either land on the home page or, yeah. On the final design. We'll look at that paper later and talk. Anyone has comments on his design? I think they didn't see the visual, so very hard to understand. Old monk. Okay. The other kind of landing page is the search results page, equally pertinent in your flow of things. A search results page, when you begin, now every homepage has two kinds of users, or every product has two kinds of users, two very clear kind of users. One is the browse type user, who will come and will want to browse, will want to look for items, will see variety, will see colors, will probably compare a couple of items. And then there is a search type user who will come, he knows what he wants, he'll directly search, get it, and get out of your site. Right? So, and you have to cater to both kinds. You have to cater to the browse kinds who will come and find his path. So it's almost like a Chinese garden where he'll take a walk and there'll be meandering paths and he should be able to see a lot of nature around him and be completely awestruck. And the other guy who's like a Mughal garden, he comes, there are straight paths and, you know, he just goes to where he wants. You know, the Chinese garden and the Mughal garden are very different in their architecture. That's how we define two different kinds of navigation patterns for a browse guy and a search guy. Somebody who's searching, ensure that you have a clear search box, hopefully placed on the top right. That is where people have got used to looking at search. I can't tell you how many researches we do where we ask them, search kahan karoge, and the first thing they look at is the top right. Because they've got used to search being there. So your search better be there. The other important thing which a lot of people probably forget to do is retaining search keywords. So after I've searched a certain keyword and I go to search results page, you know what is our memory span? Our memory span is around 7 seconds. I tell you a number, 987625432212, after 7 seconds you would have forgotten the number. Right? So if you're not consciously paying attention to what we're doing, and typing a search keyword is not a conscious thing that you're doing. You type in, for example, in FirstCry, you've typed in prams. You come to the search results page. If the search results page, if you made a typo error, the most common error on the web is typo error. If you've made a typo error and you land on a search results page, and if your keyword is not retained on the top, you would probably not even know why a wrong search result has come up. Right? So it's important for the user to have feedback on the search result page. of what the keyword that he had searched earlier was. So retain the keyword and bring it forward for him. Tell him 190 items for pram keywords. So it tells him that A, I searched for prams, there was no typo error, and even if I want to change my search keyword, you know, I search for example, on Flickr, I search for garden pictures, I don't see good pictures, I may want to just change my keyword. But if you don't tell me what my keyword was, I would have, because of 7-second memory loss, I would have forgotten what I searched for. I may end up searching the same thing again, right? Search results page, extremely important to give decision-making information. If you sometimes display 50 search results, what do you expect the user to do? Click on every search result, see the detail, come back, click on the second search result, see the detail, come back. He will never do it. So your search result page should clearly give him all the decision-making information to whether to click on this or not to click on this item. So if you look at, in fact, what Naukri does well is not just give information, it tells you the designation of the search. So on the top, it retains the keyword, the first good thing it does. Then it tells you the designation for which this job is posted, UI developer. It tells you the company, tells you the location. Then it tells you a little bit description about the job. So it's not just displaying information, also look at the information hierarchy. The order in which information is given, that's the first thing. The second thing is some information is bold, some information is unbold, some information is in big font, some information is in small font. That's not a coincidence, that's designed in that way. It's designed to tell you this is important information, and if you want to read the description in a smaller unbold font, I've also given you the description. And it also consciously puts the location in green color, so that in your scanning pattern, your eyes are, because you want to probably look for a UI developer job in Mumbai, in your scanning pattern, your eyes are now only looking for green items on the page and are seeing where is Mumbai written, because it will only click on the jobs which are in Mumbai, right? So they've identified very clearly that in my scanning pattern, location is important. A user just scans down 100 results, looks at the green item, sees that, you know, these are the locations that I'm interested in, and hence I'll click on these jobs. Description is important, but not as important. Small, not very bold. And designation with the experience is important right on the top. Again, Flipkart, very nice display of search results page. Gives you the product image, a shot of the product. Gives you rating of the product. So when you're buying a product, a lot of people said that they'll buy online if other people have rated that product or if other people have bought that product. Agar kisi aur ne khareeda hai, toh hum bhi khareedenge. Is a common phenomena. So giving it on the search result page is a good idea, that so many reviews are already there. Giving, you know, how much percentage off is also a good idea, although there's a debate on should you give absolute number in off, like should you say rupees 299 off or should you say 70% off? Because they both mean very different things. So there's no end to that debate, and there's no answer to that either. Do either or, but show one of them. Walmart, again, very interestingly laid out information. What they've done is they've again taken care of scanning pattern. Price is important. One entire column is price. So as the user scans down, he just keeps seeing the price. Whatever price, that's there probably as decision-making criteria. Whatever price suits him, he'll just click on that one. Refine and sorting criteria, another important one. Whatever refine and sorting criteria, I'm not saying you should have the same refine and sorting criteria, but whatever. For example, when you're looking at pictures on Flickr, their refined criteria or sorting criteria, small, modern, medium, detailed slideshow, because that's how you look at pictures. You want to see small pictures, you want to see medium size, you want to see a slideshow, or when you're looking at Redbus. So in fact, Redbus is, the search results page was done by us some time back. It was interesting. There, anyone from Redbus here or has at any time been associated with Redbus? No. Okay, so if you look at their earlier search results page, how do you think people buy ticket for buses? You know, what are the decision-making criteria? Price, time, AC, non-AC, comfort would be mean what? Okay. What is the condition of the bus that you're traveling in? Image, rating. Why would rating? Okay. More? More options for booking. Okay. The company, who's sitting next to you? The company of the bus. Okay. Okay. Cancellation. Okay. Cancellation policy. So, we're missing out something very interesting, which came out as a common thing that everybody said. You know what it was? We actually went to the bus stand and we started asking people, observing people, how are they buying tickets? How do they actually go about buying tickets? Two very important things which they wanted to know when they're buying tickets. I don't want to sit on the back seat. I don't want to sit on the seat on the tire. Right? These are two very, very important criteria. They don't want to do these two things. They would do it if emergency, they have to go in that bus. If given a choice, they would not do it. Right? So the location of the seat was very important for them. And if we had not gone out there, if we had not spoken to them, these were two important things we would have probably missed out in the design. So the new search results page we came up with, one could see, you know, whatever they could see here. If you see view seat button was then introduced. If you click on view seat, it expands and it actually shows you the seats which are empty. And you can make a choice which seat you want to sit on when you purchase the ticket. And the guy will give you that seat. So, which again helped in improving, I don't know about the sales, I don't know the numbers, how it improved, but at least it helped in improving the perception of the brand. That, you know, I can now, you're empowering the user to do something that he actually does in his physical world. And this is again bridging the gap between the physical world and the real world. If in the physical world and the virtual world. If in the physical world he can go and ask, ye seat kahan hogi? In the virtual world, empower him to make that choice. That where do I want to sit? Okay, so that was the refine and sorting criteria. That was about the landing pages. Now, remember the funnel? After the landing page is the product detail page. That is where your funnel starts getting narrow. We'll talk a little bit about the product detail page now. What do you think is the most important thing on a product detail page? Pictures, price? How many for pictures? And how many for price? Both are equal? Okay. Okay. But don't you think you would have seen the price in the search results page? In all probability, because on the product detail page, he generally doesn't land directly. Even through SEO, he'll land on a search results page in 80% cases, unless you're doing a campaign for a particular product. You would land him on a search results page, and from there, he'll go to a product, right? So price is not as important. It's important, but in the priority, it's the images, it's the shots. And more often that we talk to people, the more they say that, you know, we want to, it's solving the problem of how do you, you know, make a product tactile? How do you give the real feel to the product that is there? If you look at this, this is a very interesting example. This is actually in the shape that a person would be walking. Right, so you're actually seeing shoes. What they've done is they've taken a shot and they've probably removed the guy from it and they've let the shoes be. But the shot shows actually the shoes and the shape that they would be worn and the person would be walking on the road. So it's a very interesting. Yeah, it also shows all the views here. So whenever we talk to people, the one thing that we come back with on a product detail page is visuals. You know, they want to see visuals, visuals and more visuals. They want to see, if they can't touch, at least show me. And show me from all angles, right? Let me zoom it, let me, and one common mistake that I see people do on an e-commerce site in India, they crimp their budgets when it comes to product shots. Please don't do that. Take good shots of products. I know it's a slightly expensive exercise, but it's worth the doing it, right? Take good shots of, the models don't have to be extremely good looking. That can be compromised. But the product has to be displayed very well. So it's a myth that, you know, I have to spend on expensive models if I need good shots. But that's not true. As long as you, if you look at, is it Inkfruit? In fact, even, which is the other site that sells t-shirts? There's a website that sells t-shirts. They don't even show the face of the person. They just show the, there's another one, in fact, I have here. So there's another one. Look at the way they've shown the t-shirt. It's not. It's kept the way it is actually wrinkled and kept on your bed or, you know, it's a very original shot. It's not neatly arranged and artificially shot. Even the pictures that they've shown of people actually wearing it, they've shown the persona of the or the personality of the person who'd actually be wearing this t-shirt. You know, somebody who's drinking beer is wearing a helmet and going on a bike perhaps. So take that extra thought of this product can be sold better if shown with a person like this. This model doesn't look awfully beautiful, awesome, or you know, beautiful. The model is a very common person, but it tells you about the t-shirt. It's more about telling you that, you know, you can wear it. If you're going out to a party, you can wear it. If you're going on a bike, you can wear it. So give that extra thought to your product visuals. The other trend that I've seen now, on a product detail page, you'll usually have a 50-50% split. You'll have, you know, a 50% split given to visuals and only 50%. Earlier, it used to be a 40-60 or a 30-70 divide where only 30% was given to the visuals and 70% was about the product, description of the product. It's changing. It's 50% is given to the product shots and 50% is given to the description of the products. Another important thing, what do you need above the scroll on a product detail page? You just need a call to action saying buy this. Right? If he's reached the product detail page, in all probability, he's made up his mind or he is kind of wants to know more, he'll scroll down to know more. But give him buy now option on the top. A lot of sites you see a person has to scroll down to actually perform the action of buy now. If you've made him scroll down, you've probably lost his interest and he may not click on buy now. So give it on the top, let him click on it, let him take that action. This is another very good example of no clutter. You know, this is my product and this is how you buy it, add to cart. And anything else is below the scroll. There's another phenomena called upsell. You know, this is what somebody was talking about in the beginning, the difference between a brick and mortar store and a retail online store. When I'm waiting there to swipe my credit card, I may like a hanky, I may take it and put it in my pocket. You can do upsell on the web also. Now, how you do upsell on the web is up to you. You want to say that, you know, one of the ways which is very, very typical how Amazon does it, people who bought this also bought this, is one way to do it. But I always feel a better way to do it, because if you're saying people who bought this also bought this, I'm not sure if, you know, it's related. For example, the logic perhaps should be if somebody is buying, for example, an iPad, show him iPad cases, because that's the next thing he's going to buy, right? Or what Crate and Barrel does, they'll show you a chair, and just below that, they will show you our designers recommend. Now, what happens is Crate and Barrel is anyways a known brand. I trust the brand. It's a known brand in some countries. I trust the brand. I know their furniture is damn good. Now, if I think the designer's recommending something, so a pillow that probably goes with this chair, I will trust them, and I will buy it. Because I anyways have to buy a cushion for the chair, right? Might as well buy it from here because their designer is recommending it. So it's almost like free expert advice. And expert advice always sells well on the web because you've got no customer assistance. Remember, you're all alone sitting there. In the web, there's a assistance guy who's telling you that, you know, if you're buying this, iske saath ye achha lagega, or why don't you try this curtain with this rod, etc. Here, there's no one. So you have to advise him. You have to tell him this product, this will look nice with it, or why don't you also buy with it? So what you're doing in bargain is not just helping him, you're also increasing your cart size. You're increasing your how many products are being put in your cart. Another thing you can do on your product detail page is engage customers to bring in content. Engage people on Facebook, on various social media sites, to bring in content. The more rich the content is, like someone said that if there are reviews, I know whether this bus company is good or not on Redbus. So that is how typically people think. Like I said earlier, if someone else has bought it, I will also buy it. I have no fear, right? So the more the reviews that people write, the more likelihood of that product selling online.
Some
So it is a global statistics. Only 1% people actually write. If 100% visit a site, only 1% actually write. About 10% read, and about 20 or 25% recommend or star. But writing a review is only 1%. And what you're talking of India is actually true to some extent, also because of the language barrier. If you look at it, it's only English, right? How many people today are articulate in English? So it's the shy or the fear of writing something which would be, you know, not correct, perhaps grammatically, is one of the reasons why people shy away from it. It's not that they don't have intent to write. Because, you know, we had done this study with the, we were doing something with a matrimonial site. And there we had, there is on matrimonial sites, people, there is a place where people can write about themselves. They are given about 150 characters or 200 characters where they're supposed to write about themselves. And the problem the site was facing was people wouldn't write. Whatever they would do, they would send emailers, they would call them up. They would say, you know, you tell us what you want to write. We'll write it for you. People wouldn't write. And then they thought maybe that, so then we did a research and we found out the problem is actually this. The problem is being not able to articulate or use the language correct, and hence the shy or the fear of being laughed at in a public place. So what we did was we thought maybe a vernacular language will help. So we introduced to begin with Hindi, that you can now start writing your matrimonial profiles in Hindi, at least the about us section. The other sections you can fill in English, that's fine. And after 3 months or 4 months, then we evaluated, there were only 10 profiles that had actually written in Hindi. Nobody else had. So we again went back and we said, you know, why are people not writing in Hindi? And the best way to do it is actually go to people and start talking to them. When we did it, it was so interesting. People thought that, you know, if we write in Hindi, people will now perceive us that we don't know English. Pehle toh they would have a doubt that we don't know English. Now they know that we don't know English. So we would not write in Hindi, right? So there is this little fear, and that is one of the reasons why reviews are taking time for to be aggregated online. But I'm sure it will change. That depends on the number of reviews you're getting. If you've got only one or two, perhaps you'd have doubt. If you've got 50 positive reviews, then you know the company is not sitting and, I mean, they are not so idle. They're not 50 people sitting and logging in and writing reviews. So it depends on the number of reviews. But tell me, how many people actually look at the rating and go to watch a movie? How many people do that? There you go. We all do that, right? We trust them. We do not mistrust them. We are ready to spend one evening on a movie by only depending on the review that has been given by somebody else we don't know, right? Okay, the next item in the funnel, from the landing page, we go to the product detail page. From there, we go to the shopping cart page. Let's look at how BabyOi deals with it. There are numerous ways of dealing with a shopping cart. No proven right or wrong way. We're just going to talk about the various ways in which it can be done. And I can share with you some of the best practices or some of the findings that we've had on the shopping cart page. But none of them are conclusive really in the Indian scenario. So one way to do it is you click on add to cart and it opens a separate cart page altogether. Right? So you're taken to a new page where it shows you these are the products that you've added on your cart. Right? One of a very traditional ways of doing it. What is important in all the pages, in all the ways that we're going to see is your cart on the top should display the number of items in your cart. So that whenever you're shopping, the cart on the top always gives you a feedback. You've added 2 items or 3 items or 10 items in your cart. So that feedback should always be there. The other way to do it is how Flipkart does it. You click on buy this now and it opens a pop-up. It doesn't take you to a separate page. It just opens a pop-up and there it shows you, you know, this is the added product. Now, do you want to close and continue shopping or do you want to place order? So that's another way of doing it. I just look at it as two different ways depending on what do you foresee your sale as or what do you see your cart size as. If you see your cart size as 1 or 2, you can take them to the next page. If you foresee your cart size to be 5 or 6, don't take them to the next page. Just open it on a pop-up. Let them decide there whether they want to continue shopping. Because if you've taken them to a next page, it's hard to get them back to continue shopping. But if you've just opened a pop-up there, it's easy for them to close the pop-up and continue shopping. So it really depends on what you foresee your cart size as, and that is really a factor of what is the price of the product that you're selling. If you're selling a Peter England 2,000 rupees shirt, probably he'll buy 1 or 2. But if you're selling diapers, he may buy bulk. So it depends on what you're selling, what you're foreseeing your sales as. The third way is the way Zovi does. No, so yeah, they also take you to a separate page. But why I have Zovi here is when you click on buy now, it takes you here, which is the cart page. It tells you that, you know, these are the products you can check out. And on the left, it also does a cross merchandising. It tells you these are the other offers which are applicable to you. You may also want to buy it. So shopping cart page, I think, is the best page to actually do a cross merchandise where you can increase your cart size, where you can tell him that, you know, you can put more items in your cart. Here you go, there are some more things you may want to buy. I always tell people, refrain from selling similar items on a product detail page. Because a product detail page is a page where he's buying one item. You can show him related items, but you can't show him similar items there, because then you've taken him away from that item, and he'll probably not buy anything. Right? If you want to sell similar items, or you know, if you're selling shirt, you want to sell trousers with it, do that, and also do that on a shopping cart page. That's the great place where maximum merchandising happens, cross merchandising happens. Okay, a little bit about this page. What do you think of the term checkout? You know, a lot of shopping cart pages have this term called checkout. What do you think? Yeah? Finalize the deal. Okay? But what do you think in terms of correct or incorrect should be used, not to be used in the Indian scenario? It means log off? Okay. 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 So you're checking out of the shopping cart, make payment. So when we did this, we were doing a research for eBay, I think, and we showed these screens to a lot of people. They had checkout written. There were two options. You know how Flipkart has two options: place order, close and continue shopping. So the designer had given two options. On the right was checkout, on the left was continue shopping. And we asked them that now you want to make payment, what would you do? What do you think they said? How many for continue shopping? Interesting. So that's exactly what it was. Out of 30 users, I think 20 of them thought checkout was actually logging out. They would log out of the site. And continue shopping would mean that I can continue shopping, which means, you know, continue making a payment and going ahead. So especially when it comes to these pages, the terms that you use are very important, because this is the time you don't want him to fall down or, you know, drop out of your site. So be very careful about all these details. What are the terms that you're using? What's the color that you're using? Now, if you look at Flipkart, very consciously, place order is a darker orange color. Close and continue shopping is a blue color, because their primary action is, you know, place order. If you want to continue shopping, please go ahead and do it. And it's on the left. You know, place order is on the right. This is also because people think right is for going to the next thing. That is why next is always on the right. Left is always for going back. They look at web as like that. You know, it goes from left to right. So every screen is coming from here for them. So next is next to that. So it's on the right. So checkout perhaps is not a very good term for an Indian scenario. It's a very US term. In the US malls, you use the term checkout. Although shopping cart has got accepted, shopping cart was never an Indian term, but because of the malls and the shopping carts that came here, it's got accepted in India. But checkout is something still that people need to think about before they put it on their site. And now the checkout flow. Once the shopping cart is over, this is the next page where maximum dropouts happen and your funnel gets really narrow, is the checkout flow. And I think Flipkart does a beautiful job of creating a correct checkout flow. There are a couple of things which are very good with it. One is, it clearly tells you there are four steps to checkout. You're on the first step, there's a second, third, and fourth step, right? So what happens if they tell you one, two, three, four steps? It's like driving on a Mumbai-Pune highway. If I'm shown the milestone indicators, I know how many miles more. I'm more at peace when I'm driving. Otherwise, I'm restless. I don't know how many miles more, how many kilometers more to reach the destination. So if you've shown milestone indicators or if you've shown these steps, it tells the user four steps, that's all that you have, and then you're out of here. It also asks you, you know, you want to continue without password or you want to create a password. There are some sites that ask you to register before you shop, which never do well. So you give the consumer the choice that you don't want to register with us, it's okay, you can come back and register. But for now, you can just kind of go on with a guest checkout, right? Zovi, another good example. They again do two things very well. One, they've reduced the number of steps. So it's just two steps and you're out of here. The second thing they do, which is well, is they give you a feedback of the shopping cart on the right. So you also have a view of the cart of what you're buying when you're checking out. So it's another comfort factor that you have, that this is what I'm buying and, you know, now I'm going to check out. So this was about individual pages. You know, we spoke about the landing page, which is the home page, and the search results page. Then we spoke about the product detail page, the checkout, the cart page, and the checkout page. These are the four very, very pertinent pages. Any questions that we have on any of these pages so far before we go to the next one? Yeah. You're right. That's a very good question. If you look at Trendin that we've done, we've reduced it from 4 to 3 pages. We've been able to do 3. We couldn't do 2 or 1. But yes, we've reduced from 4 to 3 pages. So yes, that's a good question. You could reduce the number of pages also, because if you reduce the number of pages, you've automatically controlled the funnel dropout to some extent. Any other question?
Something like a Google search box, and then they type in, you give you all related products. Let's say there are 100,000 SKUs, you will still end up, you will do all the merchandising after that, but there is like one plain page with one search box.
So we did this comparison. Do you remember Monster.com's design about 4 years ago? They only had one search box. You could go there and 4 or 6 years ago. At that time, we were comparing Naukri with Monster, and we did this research. A lot of times, people didn't know what to put in the search keyword. You know, because they didn't know what, they knew that they were looking for a sales job, for example. They would only put sales job. But the moment they came to Naukri, which has a search keyword, and then it has location, and it has, you know, 2-3 more criteria, the search results were filtered, and they were very close to what he wanted. So we still don't know what to put in that big search keyword. We still want to be able to filter them when we're searching itself. So there is a problem. At least 6 years ago when we did this, this was very evident, that people are not comfortable with one long keyword, because they don't know what they want. Even if they don't know what they want, If you give them 2-3 more parameters to filter their results, the search results will be much better. So your dropouts on the search results will be lower. Right? I don't know if it's true anymore though. It's worth doing it again. Any other questions? Okay. So we'll move on. I think, what's the time? We just, okay. We're close to completion. The other thing is, stop designing pages and start designing flows. Designing pages is important, but designing the flow is even more important. Take various use cases in your mind. List them down. Say that, you know, when a person is coming to buy tickets on my site, he may be looking at a one-side journey, he may be looking at a return journey, he may be looking at, you know, 2-3 destinations, like a hop journey, he may be looking at a night journey. List down all your use cases and then see how your flows are working for each of those use cases. Prioritize your use cases. You know, in the bell curve, look at where is your maximum use case, or what is it that maximum people are doing on your site or are going to do on your site. But it's very, very important to look at the flows, because only when you look at the flows, you realize that, you know what, after he made a purchase, I didn't give him a thank you message. I didn't give him a confirmation message saying that thank you for making a purchase. More discounts and deals is another reason that they buy online. Free delivery on every purchase is what they expect, and I think a lot of internet companies are offering. Cash on delivery is one of the reasons that they mentioned why they buy online, because they're still wary of giving their credit card numbers, though it's changing, but cash on delivery hoga, so it's the best. Also because, you know, I don't have a credit card as a college goer. I'll just buy cash on delivery. When it comes, my dad will pay out of his pocket, right? So that's also true. So that's also one of the reasons why people prefer cash on delivery. Some reasons of why people hesitate to buy online. Not sure with the material and size, fear of credit card number being hacked, bad experience of their friends. Remember, word of mouth is extremely critical in India. If you've lost your word of mouth, you've lost your brand in India, especially with social media and online channels. Like a lot of people, I won't mention the site, but when we do a research, they mention that us site se kabhi nahi kharidenge. Kyun nahi kharidenge? Because, you know, my friend said that they don't take back the stuff, they give broken stuff, the price is low, but the product quality is not good, etc., etc. So that brand itself has lost its prestige somehow within consumers. Trust. How is trust built on an online business? The highest reason for buying on any site is a friend's recommendation. My friend bought, had a good feedback, and hence I will buy. Second, TV ads. So there are two things around TV ads. One is brand recall, which we all know that if, you know, it's on the TV, then people will remember it. The other very common phenomena, which is interesting, which I saw, was people think that if they have the money to display it on the TV, they'll be a good, they'll be a brand which has a lot of money, and hence they will not cheat the consumers. So TV ads is also related with the credit worthiness or the value of the brand. Branded items on websites increases the trust on the website a lot. Cash on delivery is also equivalent to trust on websites in India. Some findings around registration. This is interesting. Female users take registration more serious than male. I don't have a reason for it. We've kind of internally tried to ponder a lot on it. Why would females want to register? But whenever we've done a research, we would find if it's a girl participant, before buying, she would want to register. But if it's a male participant, he would first want to buy, and perhaps not if users are tired of creating usernames and passwords, they usually forget. So if you can help them not create usernames and use their email IDs instead, it will be very helpful. And do not auto-generate passwords for them. People hate it. They cannot never remember an alphanumeric password that is sent to them on an email. Ask them to create a password. In all probability, they'll use the same password that they've used on 10 other websites, but at least they'll have a recall for it. So let them create a password. Problems with registration. They shouldn't have cumbersome fields and, you know, a lot of fields to be filled in. Don't do that. Just ask him 2-3 basic things. You know, when owners start designing website, they think, iska phone number bhi le lo, email ID bhi le lo, location bhi le lo. It'll help in targeted marketing. But what you've done in the bargain is you've lost him while registering only. You've lost that guy. You could have asked him later. Let him just register with 2-3 basic fields and then go back to him later and say, you know, also give us these details. provide help with messages. I've seen a lot of people want to see help. For example, password only alphanumeric, 8 to 10 characters. Not told when I'm filling the form. After I hit submit, it suddenly says error because you did not use alphanumeric. You used less than 8 characters. But if you had told me earlier, I would have used 8 to 10 characters, right? So give him messaging when he's filling up a registration form or when he's doing a certain thing, instead of throwing in an error later. Users expect an e-commerce site to send regular emails about new arrivals and offers. So if you're starting an e-commerce store, remember it's an expectation that users have. Doesn't mean you spam them, but it just means that they would want to get regular emails and offers. In fact, we were just doing a research on a matrimonial site. I think it was Jeevan Sathi. We found that people do not come to Jeevan Sathi because today I want to look for a match for myself. So I'm going to sit on www.jeevansathi.com. They don't behave like that. How they come, 40% traffic comes through emailers. Because you send them a recommended profile or you send them people who he could be interested in, he clicks on that profile and enters the website. He does not enter the website directly through the URL, right? So remember, emails are a very important part of communicating with him or getting him to your website. But equally important is not spamming him and sending him the right communication in the email. Send him the right product in the email. If you figured out that this guy is looking for mobiles, for example, send him an email which has the latest gadgets on your web store. So profile your user and send him a communication which is accordingly. Yeah, so I think that's the end of it. Thank you so much. We can take up questions if you have any. Yeah. You've got a mic.
Hello. Yeah, in the first half, we had a discussion on what is the difference between a brick and mortar and an online store.
I can't hear you still.
Can you hear me now?
Better, yeah.
Yeah. So in the first half, we had a discussion where we were differentiating between a retail brick and mortar store and an online store. And we also took an example of Pantaloons or Shoppers Stop. Yeah. Now, for example, a Shopper Stop in New Delhi would ideally stock articles which pertain to the local customers here, as opposed to a Shopper Stop in Mumbai. But my question here is, if I have an online store, suppose if Shopper Stop were to have an online store, yeah. So if they have an online store, should they be stocking up all the national level items on the store, or should they go on segregating it on in terms of, say, okay, the online store has a different kind of audience attending to it and should not ideally be stocked up with, you know, the entire countrywide stock?
I think the answer to that lies in the fact that how much is the difference between what they sell in Delhi versus Mumbai. What happens if they start selling Mumbai products in Delhi? What happens if they start selling vice versa, Delhi products in Mumbai? Are they opening the online store because they want to enhance the India sales or they want to enhance local sales? Because if they have answers to that, they will decide whether I want to, when the user comes to the site, segregate him and ask him his location. You know, you're from Delhi or Mumbai or West Bengal, and then show them products. If not, if it doesn't matter, the products are almost similar and... you know, one of the reasons also, you know where the maximum business of an e-commerce store comes from? Which part of the country? Right. It's the 2 or 3 tier cities. It's not the metros, interestingly. 60 to 70% business comes from 2 to 3 tier cities. So why they're buying online is because they do not have the reach to such brands in their cities. That's one of the many major reasons that they buy online. In which case, does it matter whether they are reaching out to a Delhi store or a Mumbai store?
And you know, being in Bombay, the Bombay Shopper Stop might just not have Woolens at this point of time. Doesn't make any sense.
I agree. So that's dependent on who your target audience is or where you're trying to do your maximum sale. You will have your user profiling. You can never say that my user profile is all India. You will have a user profiling. If you look at FirstCry and BabyOi, even today, FirstCry is not selling anything woolen. BabyOi is really selling everything woolen on their homepage. So, because BabyOi has realized that we want to sell woolen clothes on the homepage, FirstCry has realized we don't want to sell on the homepage. So, it's because probably FirstCry is selling more to the west and BabyOi is selling more towards the north. So, that's a call that they are taking based on where they are selling their items more.
I have a question which is sort of similar to his. Should the sites, is there a differentiation between city-centric or geographic-centric websites or national websites?
I haven't seen the difference. There's a difference between country-wise websites. If you look at McDonald's Germany, it'll be very different from McDonald's UK, from McDonald's India. So country-wise, culturally, there's a lot of difference, and hence there's a difference in the website.
But you do not see any difference between a Chennai shopper versus a Delhi shopper?
There is a difference. There is definitely a difference.
How do you incorporate that?
So, it is incorporated in the way you show your thing. So, Bharat Matrimony has done that, right? They have Tamil Matrimony and they have West Bengal Matrimony and Punjabi Matrimony, and they've differentiated it. They've said that, you know, if you're a Tamilian, go to Tamil Matrimony, okay. Do not come to Punjabi Matrimony. Also, because if you see Punjabi Matrimony, they'll be focused more on pictures. If you look at Tamil Matrimony, there'll be focus which is more on nakshatra and the charts. So, yes, those consumers
so your,
are different.
URL-based segregation, I mean, one brand could have multiple regional URL brands.
That could be one way of doing it, or you land them on the same site and you just ask them the region and you take them. But I haven't seen that on an e-commerce store. I've seen that on Matrimonial though, but on an e-commerce store,
like
I haven't seen that distinction.
Fashion could put like Delhi fashion versus Mumbai fashion, I mean, in the lifestyle, because lifestyles are greatly different from place to place. So
I agree.
Would you see a reason to have the regionalism aspect catered in the website naming or design?
I think it's more metro now. I don't know. I don't have an answer to that. But you should ask everybody here. Does it matter whether you're buying in Delhi or Bombay? With the winter wear, I would agree. But with the fashion, I wouldn't completely agree. What is in Bollywood is in fashion. So be it Mumbai or Delhi or Chennai. But if you're asking how to go about it, URL-based segregation is one way you could do it. The other is you land him on the same URL. You ask him which region you're in. He chooses the region and you just have shopper stop slash Chennai. So you don't have different URLs per se, but you have the same URL, just segregated with a slash. That could be other way to do it. But I don't see a reason why you would want to do it like that.
If I can maybe answer, because we represent Shopper Stop, so...
I see.
ShopperStop.com. So, one clarification again. Every single store of ShopperStop is a different store in terms of size. But when it comes to merchandise, we have almost 93% of the stocks that you would find it in a ShopperStop Mumbai and a ShopperStop Delhi or maybe a ShopperStop Amritsar. Those are all same because we are dealing in fashion. The remaining 7% would be the seasonal products. So, rains happening in Mumbai, Chennai, down south, or maybe happening winter wear in the north. So, those are the only time when things change. Otherwise, that is how we are able to actually build in some kind of a standardization. So, when we are purchasing, it is purchase made considering the across India map and not specific to cities.
And what you would perhaps do is your inventory would depend on the region. So perhaps skirts sell more somewhere versus suits. So you would have more inventory of that versus that, but you would have the same items everywhere.
Yes, absolutely. So what happens is again the size set that is available in a store. So if in case I have a 1 lakh square feet store in Mumbai, so wherein I'm having say 500 brands, vis-a-vis maybe a Gurgaon store which would have not 500 brands but somewhere around 300 brands. It will make sure that those 300 brands will have the same depth. So which means that in a Mumbai store I would be keeping a 5 size set wherein in Gurgaon I will be keeping a 1 size set.
Right. That answers your question. So fashion isn't really different across the country. Yeah.
Bombay stores on fashionnew.com to pick up merchandise which they know their friends in Bombay are wearing, and they would love to have it, but they can't right now because they can't go to Bombay and can't get it from, you know, Park Street, right? So
yeah, it's also the other way. So in Bombay, people crave for Delhi wear.
Exactly, yeah. So it could be, I've never actually seen it formalized as a design element or an element of the persuasion for
so
people.
I remember seeing
but
the
I
site
think it would be interesting
URL.
To delve into that.
But that site actually lets you choose the locality. So, you know, you can choose Sarojini Nagar, you can choose Karol Bagh, you can choose Fashion Street in Mumbai.
Exactly.
And then you can see stuff that is sold there and you can buy it. So there is a site like that. I don't remember their name though.
Really?
There is a site, yeah.
Big Mota store, does the image get carried over if you're carrying the same branding, assortments and other things?
It does. Brand is a very high recall. So if you're carrying the same brand name, the image gets carried over and people expect the same level of quality which they get from a store. So when we were doing, we are redoing the HR Johnson website where they're also, there are a lot of features that they're introducing. Yeah. When we did the research, the one thing that people felt was that on their current website, not the redone one that we're doing, when I go to their store, like House of Johnson or, you know, a Johnson tile store, the guy, the sales guy assists me and he knows a lot about the products. So I get educated when I go there. When I come to the website, there is no education whatsoever. You don't tell me what are the new products, new tiles that you've got in the market. You don't tell me what are the new products that you're experimenting with, which tile looks nice with which tile, which a sales guy tells me. So then I realize that the expectation is that my perception or my service quality of an offline brand should get translated into my online brand. That is an expectation.
So can I go on saying that if you're successful on brick mortar model, you would be more likely to be successful there on the e-commerce platform?
If you can replicate the model, yes.
Yeah, right.
If you can give the same quality of service, yes. But yes, because you already have an advantage because your brand is well known. You already have an advantage there.
Hi, my question is, why is it that we don't have too many food and grocery web stores in comparison to the brick and mortar that we see? In fact, a brand like Food Bazaar also is not online as yet. That is
grocery stores? Anyone from Bangalore here? Yeah, but half of Bangalore buys grocery online now. And there have been interesting researches around this, why Delhi is so low in catching up versus Bangalore versus Bombay. If you see the geography of Bombay, there is a market and just above that is a house because of scarcity of land. So market is not away from your house. So you don't want to go to an online store. When you come back home, you buy from the market below and you climb up the stairs to your house. Hence, Bombay is probably not doing well. If you look at the geography of Bangalore, there is, you know, Whitefield, which has houses, there's no market, which has houses, apartments, as well as offices. So they go to work, they come back home, how do they buy grocery? So then they buy grocery online, where the guy will deliver it to your office, and you just, on your way back home, carry it. Now, if you look at Delhi, it's not about geography as much, but it's also a joint culture, a joint family culture. So somebody in the family will buy, even if the couple is busy. So that's why they say that Delhi hasn't really caught up because of there are so many helping hands in the house versus Bangalore, which has more nuclear families. So people have all the time to go and work, but no time to buy. And Bombay, because of its geography, has got restricted in grocery shopping. But Bangalore has a lot of them. There's Breadbasket and lots of them. Yeah.
Well, my question is more related to the user behavior on the internet, something to do with display advertising, right? Related to probably travel, e-commerce, or maybe any other vertical, right? So we were talking about user behavior on the website. Now, do you have any comments about getting higher click-through rates on display ads? Something to do with probably aesthetics or maybe product display or maybe some structures around which can, because one of the challenges is click-through rates, getting higher click-through rates. We were talking about websites, but I think this is one interesting area which is one challenge when it comes to display ads. Even
so
for e-commerce
display
players.
Ads have I've seen how they your click-throughs can become higher on display ads is give the communication very, very clear. You know what you're trying to sell. Is it a discount that your campaign is trying to sell, or is it a product, is it a service? what are you trying to sell? The communication is very important. You change the communication and you'll suddenly see that your click-through rates have changed. So that communication is important. Use of words like free, now, are very important. If you can give reviews there, it's very important. So there are some 7-8 tips and pointers that I can maybe send you later, which help in increasing click-through rates of display ads.
Thank you.
Are we allowed a second question, or I have a quick question.
Sure.
The kind of websites that you've talked about are primarily product-oriented websites. Hmm. There is another big segment of websites, informational websites, directory websites, and media website, or the content-oriented websites. Do you have any take on them, you know, as to the need for those and the demand for the informational media-type websites and how to monetize them?
There's a huge demand for media-based websites. Monetization is a very difficult question to answer. No one has really figured that out. Somebody talks of a subscription-based monetization model. Somebody talks of, you know, there are various models that people have spoken of, but none of them have really done well as far as monetization goes. So that's an answer I think I can't give. But there's a huge demand. But everyone wants free content. That's the problem. Yeah. The pricing of? Of products, or are you? The product pricing is, I think, that's nothing to do with the user interface. It's something that you have to figure out what you want to sell this product at and how much is your consumer going to buy it at. So I wonder if it has anything to do with the design and the user interface. Okay.
What's
I've got.
Last question.
Pradeep is going to take the session now. Guys, you have a long day. There's another session. We'll park the questions. Later, I'm here. I'm attending. Yeah, I'm attending Pradeep's session anyway, so I'm here. So we can take the questions then. Right? Thanks a lot. Thanks for being such a patient audience. Thanks.